Dear Rocksteady Studios, or is it DC Comics?
DC Comics.
Or Telltale, or I don't know. There's like 1,000 developers and publishers and owners of the Batman IP. I can't keep them straight anymore. Hi, it's me, Austin. I'm here to ruin your day. You know, Batman has definitely gotta be my favorite superhero. Stretching to way back, when I was a little kid, he was definitely in the top three, along with Zorro and Indiana Jones. For years, my favorite movie was Batman Returns, although if I'm being entirely honest, my main focus was Catwoman. Huh. Catwoman, Zorro, Indiana Jones, a lot of whips going on there. I guess how I like to spend my free time in post-pubescence really isn't that much of a mystery. Where was I? Oh, right! Ruining Batman! I love Batman. Because of this, I play almost every Batman game I can get my hands on. My first one being the Batman Returns for the SNES, where I had to punch my beloved Catwoman in the face. Ah! The torture! Anyway, recently I played through the Telltale Batman series, and holy crap, I freaking loved it! And when it was over, I immediately started mainlining the Arkham series so I could perpetuate my Batman addiction, and holy crap, guys, I just realized Batman is a god. Damned murderer! And, like, this wouldn't be a big deal for a comic book superhero, but we're not talking about Punisher or Deadpool. This is freaking Batman! He's got two rules: no guns and no killing.
I'm not a coward who hides behind a gun.
But Batman is a bad boy. Batman is a vigilante, and Batman doesn't believe in following the rules, including, it turns out, even his own. Austin, Batman's not a murderer, I hear you typing frantically into the comments. He even says so, and we have evidence! The evidence being, like, you never see him do it! Oh yeah? Oh yeah, you think so, huh? Well, let me strap on my lab coat, my science hat, and prove to you, conclusively, that the Caped Crusader is the worst superhero of all time. I first realized something was up while doing one of my favorite moves in Arkham Asylum, the vertical upside down takedown, where you hang upside down and grab mooks that pass underneath you. You then tie rope to their ankles and just let go. That's some savage as hell treatment, but it's not fatal, right? Right? Wrong! Now, listen, I'm not gonna say that hanging upside down is fatal. In fact, there's been a few studies that look at this exact thing because in 1980, Richard Gere played a male escort in the movie American Gigolo, and there was a scene of him working out while suspended upside down, and oh my god, the 80s, could you not? Anyway, the sight of the then gorgeous man flesh and sex idol doing a thing made everybody else want to do that thing, so naturally, inquiring scientific minds wanted to know, is hanging upside down dangerous? Turns out, well, no. Kinda. Sorta. Hanging upside down itself is not that dangerous, but it does create a 25% increase in blood pressure. This happens because the heart is actually designed to pump harder towards your head. This is because gravity pulls your blood down towards your feet. If you're upside down, however, your blood is pumping hard towards your head, which is also getting helped by the force of gravity. The good news is the blood is pooling in the right direction. If you have to choose between too much blood in your head and too little, I recommend too much. Too little can starve your brain of oxygen and kill you within minutes if you're not careful. However, high blood pressure isn't good. I mean, if it gets high enough, blood vessels can burst. The important ones. The ones that bring oxygen to your brain. This can cause pressure on your brain and force you to lose consciousness and suffer permanent debilitating brain damage. Anybody that knows someone that's had a stroke can attest to this. It's not an easy thing to recover from. But a healthy-ish adult being hung upside down is really unlikely to suffer a stroke with a 25% increase in blood pressure without some other factor coming into play. And it's here that we get our first gruesome murder technique of the Dark Knight. You see, because Batman isn't just casually lowering criminals down. They're not just gently hanging there like Richard Gere's moose knuckle. He straight up drops them like they're made of dog poop. These mooks are pretty close to Batman's height, and we can actually calculate how fast they drop using their bodies as a frame of reference. If Batman is 6'2", or 1.87 meters, that means that these mooks are dropping over 4.5 meters. With an acceleration of G, or 9.81 meters per second squared, this means that these bros, by the time they reach the end of the rope, they're traveling over 9.3 meters per second, or over 20 miles per hour. Then, like that, they snap to a halt. And then you can flick away and see that their heart rate rises to about 155 beats per second. Fun! The game says that this is because they're terrified, but you know what? I think it's worse. I think it's because they're experiencing immense pain. You know why? Because if someone ties a rope around your ankles and just drops you that distance from something that's not a freaking bungee cord, your ankles experience over 40,000 newtons of force as the rope snaps taut and your bones flex. This is way, way more than enough force to snap your flimsy ankles and probably break a couple other bones in your legs and dislocate your hips. These mooks are in agony, but it gets worse. These dudes hanging upside down are knocked unconscious in a little over 10 seconds. Now, passing out from pain is possible, but it's really unlikely, it turns out. When people pass out from pain, it's usually from some other factor. And then the unconscious episode is temporary. No, this is something else. And you're more likely to pass out from low blood pressure, not high blood pressure, which, as you'll recall, your blood pressure while upside down increases. Something else is happening here. Something worse. Something terrible. Rapid deceleration and broken bones means one thing: internal bleeding. Bones contain bone marrow, and the legs contain a major artery, the femoral artery. If put under the right stresses, mixed with a little bad luck, and the wrong amount of torque, this artery can shear open. Even worse, internal organs can experience what's called deceleration trauma, which is when your internal organs experience severe enough G-forces and literally tear away from surrounding blood vessels. This is bad news because these mooks experience a whopping 58 Gs. This means me, a 65 kilogram man, would suddenly feel like I weigh a massive 3,700 kilograms, or over 8,000 pounds. Broken bones plus possibly severed major arteries and veins plus high blood pressure plus a high heart rate is a recipe for one horrific condition: hypovolemic circulatory shock. High blood pressure plus a fast heart rate, either induced by panic or pain, means that those severed blood vessels are gonna lose blood a lot faster. This causes a damaging positive feedback loop where a bad supply of blood leads to rapid cell damage, which leads to an inflammatory response by the body to increase blood flow to that area, which in turn deprives the body of more precious blood, which causes more cell death. And oh my god, it is just the worst thing. Shock is a major cause of death among people with major illnesses, and if left untreated, the risk of death is basically 100%, especially if you reach stage 4 hypovolemic circulatory shock. Stage 4 is defined by a low blood pressure due to there not being a ton of blood left circulating, an incredibly fast pulse over 140 beats per minute, followed by one of two things: coma or death. This is the only stage that has lack of consciousness as a symptom. Once stage 4 is reached, brain death can happen in as little as 10 minutes without an immediate blood transfusion. And we can even measure this using what's called the shock index, a tool that emergency medical responders use to assess situations. It's really, honestly, pretty simple. Heart rate divided by blood pressure. Given that the average blood pressure is 120 plus 25% for being upside down, and given that Batman actually reads their beats per minute, we can determine that this mook with a heart rate of over 150 and a blood pressure of 150 has a shock index of 1.033. Anything over 0.9 is bad, and that number is gonna get higher as he experiences further blood loss. Best case scenario, we're talking persistent vegetative state. Nobody who passes out from being upside down for a long period of time has a long and healthy life ahead of them. Even if not everyone he does this to dies, considering the rate at which he loves to dangle mooks in front of their friends, Batman has at least killed, like, 5 dudes this way. You know, like a murderer. But to be entirely honest, this is the least terrible thing that he does. If we're being generous, we can just admit that this is a game mechanic. Rocksteady just wanted to put mooks permanently out of commission, and they didn't want to think about it that hard. Big whoop! Rocksteady doesn't accurately model hanging people upside down. Color me surprised! Unfortunately, though, this is just an appetizer for the main course, because what I have for you next will blow your goddamned minds. You and I know that the whole hanging people upside down thing is, at the end of the day, a parlor trick. Batman does it to freak people out. This isn't what Batman is at his heart. The thing he does best, better than anybody, is fisticuffs. The best way to fight crime is by punching it into submission. No risk of death, no guns, no gadgets, just good old pummeling till they stop moving. Except, as it turns out, beating people until they stop moving is really, really bad for them. Just ask No-Dos after Duco's done with him. But Austin, I hear you saying, being somewhat annoying and interrupting my video, what about boxing? I mean, that's an entire thing, a thing about punching people until they don't move anymore, and nobody dies in that sport. Worst case scenario, they lose an ear or two. Okay, well, you have a fair point. Boxing is, along with American football, built upon a solid foundation of normalizing permanent and debilitating brain damage. But it's really rare for people to drop dead. That being said, since 1890, there have been over 700 in-ring deaths in boxing. So, that's fun. Why is that? Well, it all boils down to your brain. I used to think that a knockout in boxing was a straight-up coma state, non-responsive, visually dead. This actually isn't the case. Boxers who are knocked out rarely lose consciousness entirely, and if they do, it's for less than a second. In order to understand this, we're gonna have to look at the nature of punching, brains, and concussions. The worst part to get punched in is the chin. This seems counterintuitive since it's really far from the brain, but that's exactly what makes it so dangerous. You see, in order to cause brain damage, minor or otherwise, you have to make the brain impact with something. You can do this by punching someone in the top of the head, but you have to hit them really hard. The best way, though? The best way is to actually get the skull to rotate really fast so the brain, which is suspended in fluid, jiggles around and smacks into the walls of the skull. Because hitting the chin imparts the most rotational force and leverage, this is one of the best places to land a knockout punch. Boxers call it the button, which to me is just a horrifying colloquialization of destroying someone's nervous system. Other good places are the side of the head near the temples because the bone is softer and it also imparts rotation. When the brain experiences an impact, even a minor one, the person's brain is permanently damaged. Acutely, this is called a concussion, and all knocked out boxers have concussions and experience a ton of cognitive impairment. As with just about everything in humanity, this isn't a simple on-off switch. It's a gradient, measurable by the Glasgow Coma Scale. The Glasgow Coma Scale is a metric that takes a bunch of symptoms, assigns a number to them, and adds them together to give people a general idea of what's going on. A severely knocked out boxer, for example, would have a Glasgow score of about 9. They open their eyes in response to questions, they mutter incoherently, and they don't react to pain normally. But what on earth does this have to do with Batman? Batman isn't punching people until they fumble around like they're drunk. He's knocking them out cold for hours. To test this, I even left my game running overnight to see if the mooks he punched out ever wake up. They don't! They don't respond to pain in the form of me batteranging them to hell, they don't talk, they don't open their eyes! These guys register as a 3 on the Glasgow Coma Scale. This is colloquially called two things. Number one, a deep coma, or number two, death. Even if we're talking a Glasgow scale of higher degrees, like 5 or 6, the death rate of all people, even if they get medical treatment, that reach this level of brain damage is 17%. That means out of every 10 mooks Batman beats into non-responsiveness and leaves face down in a puddle of their own blood, at least one of these dudes is dying. When someone isn't moving like this, it's because they're experiencing hematomas, epidermal, subdural, intracerebral, take your pick. That's what happens when you beat on someone until their middle meningeal artery pops open. And Batman punches the crap out of a lot more than 10 dudes in the Arkham series. It's like in the hundreds. And what about these shock gloves that are powerful enough to stop hearts? Or what about the fact that when you choke someone until they lose consciousness, they wake up almost as soon as blood flow returns to the brain, which means the only way these dudes you're choking out are staying down is because you're probably severing their spinal cords. Or there's this explosive gel that literally blows up walls. Batman, you are literally blowing people up and showering them in cement shrapnel. You are making grenades! And the Batmobile has a freaking mounted gun! What happened to no guns?
This is a gun?
Starting to think that this whole no killing thing is just some propaganda perpetuated by the police of Gotham, who are paid by Wayne Enterprises to cover up the massive number of homicides Batman is responsible for. Batman lowers the crime rate, so who cares if he kills 17 to 30% of the people he interacts with? If that isn't a smoldering indictment of the American justice system, I don't know what is. Batman is either a liar and a freaking serial killer with no conscience and a hatred of the poor, or his rich upbringing literally made him so isolated from the struggles of the everyman that he doesn't know what death is.
Do you not know what death is?
Maybe he never got grief counseling after his parents died and he literally thinks the villains are sleeping. I mean, his main form of therapy is cosplaying in a fetish outfit and punching people in the skulls until they no longer remember their high school education. This is exactly why we need transparency in our policing system. This is exactly why we have checks and balances. Batman's checks and balances are a mentally ill man in clown makeup and a giant roided out jock. Congratulations, Rocksteady. You made Batman a freaking killer. Or I guess he always was one. But you made him a worse one. You upgraded him from occasional whoopsie of negligence to full-blown mass murderer. Congratulations! You made me ruin my favorite superhero. I hope you're happy. Sincerely, Austin. Thank you everyone for watching my video on Batman! Batman! Follow me on Twitter at AR Horrigan, subscribe to the Game Theorist, and you know, do something awesome! I still love Batman, even though he's a jerk. Everyone's a jerk. I'm a jerk. I ruin fun things for fun. Anyway, bye! Love ya!